So, Teck Yin, I want to ask you, I mean, Active SG was created precisely for this purpose, to get the ground, to get involved. And I guess so far, here so far, you've got what, 700?
We have 000? Now 810,000 members.
You want to share with us some of your experiences in that?
Well, the key thing that Active SG was set up to do was to provide a platform and a channel to partner. Mm. When there are partners that need help, like schools, they need help with additional facilities. They need help with additional capacity from a coaching perspective. They need help with a collaboration with another government agency when it comes to maybe an issue of resources, budget. We can certainly partner schools to help. There are small academies everywhere. They need help in being able to extend their reach. They need help in having a community of practice that improves their coaching methods, their coaching techniques. They need help in sort of making sure that facilities are available at certain times and for us to be able to look at a master schedule of activities that make use of these facilities. Everybody wants it all at the same time. How do we work with different partners to extend this?
So has the response been strong on the ground?
I think it has been very strong. We were planning for Active SG to take on about 200,000 members in the first year. Within the first year, it grew to 700,000. Today, slightly more than a year, we're sitting at 810,000.
And these are active members. They're just
60% are very regular. Mm. And I think from a sporting culture standpoint, when we think about it, when we actually look at our participation levels across the board compared with other cities in the world, cities that we consider to be sporting cities, our numbers actually compare quite favorably. However, there is a difference between people that just keep physically active. There are many Singaporeans who go jogging versus getting out there to play games.
Yeah.
Right? What we'd like to be able to nurture is more games, more what we call sport, and not just physical activity, because we think that the social outcomes from playing games is actually very useful for all the values that Kofan spoke about.
Right. Venkat.
I would actually like to bring back to the point about the education system. Because like, I feel that while the government come up with all these fancy terms to promote sporting excellence and all that, it's just that the education in Singapore is not practical to nurture sporting talents, at least as of now. Because, first reason, right, the schooling hours are really long. You know, some might argue that it's not really long, but there's remedials, there's supplementaries, there's extra lessons, there's projects, a lot of projects. And one of my friends in secondary school, his schooling hours are from 7:30 in the morning to 9:30 at night. It's lessons, it's compulsory. So like...
Every day?
Yeah. So like, how do you expect to nurture the athletes? And you look at our school, right, there isn't even hybrids. And the timetable is so unhealthy. So it kind of sends the wrong signal in my opinion. And so many of us are sleep deprived. And there's so much homework, so many assignments and all that. Yeah. My point is that, right, you will still produce the athletes. It's just that the talent pool will shrink.
So many of you here are students. Mm. Would you like to share your experience? Yep. Would you agree that that's true?
Okay, Sham, you want to say something and then we'll go to our young man.
Yeah, I think we were talking about there are a lot of third world countries where there's a very organic interest in sport. And we are such
By
a...
By the way, third world countries.
I mean, yeah, okay.
Politically incorrect.
Politically incorrect, right? A lot of countries that are not as...
developing.
Not as developed as us that have an organic interest in sport. Everyone just loves sports. And we are so fortunate to have such a comprehensive like infrastructure and policy, like policy-wise, to facilitate so many things like in terms of venues and so many formal mechanisms. But I think the issue is so complex because it's something innately Singaporean. It's the Singaporean pragmatism that is the stumbling block that prevents people from taking that step. And you know, they are so pragmatic that sometimes they look at sports as, I think it's a waste of time. At the end of the day, you need to look at your studies at the end of the day. So it's something that has been ingrained in us over the years inadvertently. You know, that culture of excellence, but it's always very paper driven. So now, no matter how hard Sports SG tries to put in place all these mechanisms if that cultural mindset isn't eroded.
Yeah, but the question is, it's a chicken and egg situation.
Yeah. How do we do it?
Who is supposed to change it? Is it the government's responsibility? Right?
Many of you here are schooling. You made the choice. Your parents supported. And I imagine you would support your children.
It. And many of the students, many of our athletes in SEA Games who won the awards are all active students. How do they manage it? You know, I think, I want to go to Prithiv first. Yeah. Can we go to Prithiv for a moment? He had asked for a comment. Yeah.
So, well, I can relate to what he said over there. Because I'm a student. I'm very young. So, the timing that the classes are at is very peculiar because they start at 8. And, you know, sometimes you leave very far. So, for me, I have to wake up at, like, sometimes 4:30 a.m., go to the track. I have to go to, like, my college track. So, sometimes I have to wake up early, do my 10 k.m. So, and then it's all about time management, you know. So I guess Singapore is being very particular about education, but they should be a little bit conducive to the student athletes.
Even as you're speaking, Prema Govindan was grimacing as a former athlete. Okay, can you explain your grimace, please?
I think we've spent a lot of time talking about what is not around. But if you really look at the Singapore spirit, it starts in the home. You know, so we keep saying, what is Active SG going to do? What is, what are the schools going to do? But we forget, if you go back, it's taken 40 years for us to see the sort of success that we've seen in the SEA Games. And what's happened over the 40 years, all of these things, right? Education has taken foremost place in the homes. Parents are fearful that their children do not get this future education and a good life, as they may say. So if we go back to the basics of Kampung Spirit, okay, I'll just give you an example of how it hit me when I was in Woodlands. I live in Woodlands and I see these huge banners and you suddenly think that, oh, this is our homegrown talent. This is my Woodlands athlete. You know, so maybe we should harness that and get the community
the spirit. It,
that whole spirit. Which is what actually ignites people.
Yeah, actually, I must say, I agree with you. Yeah. That was a fantastic, one of the greatest things you did, where in each community, you see the sportsman from your community. Who came up with the idea? Definitely not the minister, right?
Definitely not me.
What idea?
No, I think tribute to our grassroots leaders who understand what inspires their community.
Right.
This came from the grassroots.
Wonderful.
And so we work with the grassroots to make that apparent. But, you know, from where I sit, there are a few things that stand out. Because, yes, my son is in supplementary class this week. It's called PSLE, right? So this morning I dropped him in school for supplementary class. But as we speak right now, he's at the water polo pool. Right? He's at the water polo pool. We make choices, and as parents, we need to support our children. But from where I sit, there are a few factors that can set us up for success, because these factors influence the way people feel. The first is physical literacy. No kid has a lot of fun when they can't coordinate. Mm. When they get out there and want to play and can't for the life of them catch a ball, throw a ball, hit a ball.
But they can coordinate Xbox.
They can coordinate Xbox and they love it because it's a game. Sport, by definition, just to get back to the business of sport, is games with physical activity. It's a game with physical activity. That's what it is. And we, as human beings, are designed to play and have fun, and we're designed to move.
Yeah.
The more literate we are in being able to move as a child, the more you can't stop the child from playing sport. Because he will play. He will make up his own games even if it's not a formal sport like football. The more physical literate you are, the more you're going to get out there and play. And that's something that MOE is working very hard to recognize the importance of physical literacy. And ActiveSG is trying to do that as well. The programs that we're sending for kids now, I've got a PhD looking at the design. A design early childhood development and movement skills. In order to make sure that program is understood by parents, understood by the child, that you're not just having fun, you're doing something that makes you feel confident about your physical
ability. But the larger point here that's coming through clearly is choices, what you said. You know?
Yes.
And I don't think, whether it's sports or if you want to excel in anything, I don't think there are any shortcuts, you know. I mean, there are certain choices you've got to make. You have to forego a certain amount of sleep, right? All of you are sportsmen. You know that if you're a sportsman, you got to go to school earlier than anyone else. And you got to, you'll probably be one of the last to leave the school. You'll be very tired a lot of the time. I mean, these are sacrifices that sportsmen have to make, or people who want to excel have to make. And the support has to come clearly from the family. The support has to come from increasing the community. But I think we should stop looking at the government to change culture. I think that's an oxymoron. The government should keep away from culture.
No, I would actually say that what you put in place are options. I mean, compared to where we were in the past, for example, school. I would like to know actually what school. If you actually could name the school, I'd be quite happy to know what school is it where students go every day, 7:30 to 9:30. But the fact of the matter, you're a sports school. You're offering an option. You have art school, SOTA, for those who are interested in arts. For those who perhaps academically they may be strong or they may have other interests, sports-wise, and you can pursue that. And as Tek Yin mentioned, IHL, I think today, I mean, and I wrote a letter to IHL, it was one of my residents' appeal for a student, and actually it was really moving. So the fact is that you provide support systems so that options are exercised. But the last mile needs to be walked by you or walked by us. We make those choices. But you realize that we often talk as if we have no choice. We are victim of circumstances. Are we? None of you here are victim by circumstances. You made your choices. You made your sacrifices. But that's why you are where you are. And that's why you inspire many of us. And in the same way, I think you would offer those choices to your children, as we all have to make those choices.
Yeah.
But what we need to do is to facilitate as much as we can. It's not perfect. Improve what we can do in the schools, improve what we can do with Sports Singapore, improve what we can do in SNOC. But I think when you look at in the overall scheme of things, things have begun to move, and I think it will have to continue along the trajectory. Yeah. But that last mile walk, that action they need to take, yeah, that has to be done by all of us.
Colin, I want to ask you, maybe you can share with us some of the sacrifices, inverted commas, that Joseph had to go through.
Well, when Joseph went to the U.S. when he was 13 years old, he had to go into grade 8, he sacrificed a year and went backwards, or went into the curriculum for the U.S. and learn again the American system and so forth. And I put him into to stay in the dorms for a year, because I had to break all the bad habits that he had. He had his maid to take care, he had a driver to drive him. So I had to break this all by baptism of fire. So after a year, I said, no, I wish to grow old with my son and to also inculcate values. So we spent 5 years. When my wife was there, because that was part of the US ruling, that the boy underage is not allowed to stay in the US alone in a home.
Mm.
We had a home. So one of us, me or myself, had to be there. So when me went there, it's out of a year, 6 months there, 6 months back, and it continued for 5 years. So those are big sacrifices. But the key is, he enjoyed what he did and he progressed every time. But the key is enjoying what he does. Even he speaks and writes Mandarin. No? Why? Because when I initially, when he was going to school, I had a Chinese friend who told me, Colin, even if he cries learning, you never feel sorry. He had to go through this agony, but he never. I told him, whatever you do, you enjoy. So he enjoyed it.
Right.
There's one thing more, if I can add, you know,
yeah,
to all of us here. Joseph's coach, Eddie Reese, just came in and he made a very important statement. He says, Joseph is like Michael Peltz and Ryan Lochte. They chose a sport that suited them. Just like Ernie Iles, when he was young, he had talent identification. They went through that, and he was actually a good cricketer, a good rugby player, and a golfer. But he, because of his bones and his muscle fiber and blood count and so forth, he was suited as a golfer. So I think all of us here also must look in that scientific perspective. Yeah. You know?
What is suited? What is
SSI suited has the facilities. Singapore now has these facilities. So even like Joseph, when he was young, I sent him for an X-ray that was taken to China, the Sports Institute in Hubei, and they found out that he will be about 6'4 or 6'2, sorry.
Mm.
And he is about 6'2.
6'2.
Because I didn't want him, because at the when he was racing in school, he was the shortest and the smallest. But now he's the reverse, you know.
Thank you.
This is another thing for us as parents, and also to think. This was an advice from one of the best aquatic scientists in the world. He said, I said to him, Bill, I'm worried. I see Joseph is so small, he's not growing, you know. So he told me one thing, Colin, I'm not going to be too scientific with you, and I'm just going to say this to you. Just remember, an apple that ripens early also rots early. So
that probably explains a lot of things for me in my life.
Let's not let our children go and progress on their own, and, you know. And this improve on their own merit, on their own speed.
Thanks, Colin. Thanks. So far, we talked about building an ecosystem, right? And I think one of the best initiatives we've had in Singapore is really creating the sports school, right? But some people say that the sports school, the way we manage it, and the follow-through from the sports schools can be improved. What are your thoughts on that?
I enjoy looking at my athlete being part of sports school. Sports school for Silat, it have made Silat for this past few years, because majority of the athletes from my elite athlete come from sports school, and I can see that more to come, and I would like to see that the sports school not only ends at secondary 4, 5, or maybe there will be some other program that leads them to poly and so on. Why not we make it an extension right up to university? Something like that, from below, they be part of sports school, and it develops right on, and you can create a champion, Olympic champions from sports school. I can see that happen because it happens to my athletes, and I think it's a great setup that we have a sports school that we can beat other countries or better than them. Like I can see that in Thailand, they have a lot of sports school. We only have one. And we need to be more active in terms of developing education at sports school and training and compete. Because that is what we set up for.
Right. So I want to pick up your point about follow through from sports school, perhaps even extending it to tertiary level. You know, are there plans for that? What are your views, Gary, Kenneth? Mark, perhaps, you know?
I think sports school is a very wonderful initiative. I think elite sports, you have to reach that elite level. I think there are certain developmental exercises that you have to do at a certain age, which is where sports school really comes into the picture. But moving ahead, I think there are some gaps that we really need to close. For example, the male athletes, after 6-7 years of development in sports school, they spend 2 years in NS. And then if they're not as lucky as Joseph Schooling, sometimes they go back to zero and they have to pick them up again. And those crucial years of NS, 19 to 21, I think everyone here will agree that these are the most important developmental years of our athletes to help them take the next step to the elite level. So the question is, what are we going to do about it? I mean, we can have a wonderful tertiary program to absorb the sports school athletes, but we have not solved that problem of that two missing years. And I think today we're very privileged to have two ex-generals sitting in the panel who can perhaps shed some light also on
Before we go to the ex-generals, I want to hear from... I'm building up before we come to the ex-generals.
Drink water first.
Mark, swimming is a big part of sports school.
Yeah,
do you agree with the point that Kenneth is raising?
Yes, I think sports school is a great initiative. Again, at 13 to 16 years old, you can do wonderful things in that, in those few years to develop an athlete. But the moment they enter NS, or the attrition rate in Singapore sports, not just in swimming, is highest after O levels. A lot of them, they just quit. They get off the map. A lot of them go to A-levels, a lot of them go to polytechnics, and then they get interested in other things. We need to see how we can continue this
momentum. So it's not even NS. The moment they go into JC, A-levels, they lose interest. What happens?
I don't know about you. I did my A-levels. It's the hardest exam I've taken in my life.
Oh, okay.
The amount of time and dedication it takes is just the depth of knowledge that is required to do the A-levels. It's not easy. But now students have the options. You know, they can go to polytechnics, and it's no longer... No, I personally feel you don't need a degree to really succeed in Singapore. You're just given the skills and you're able to find a job reasonably well. But I think that's something that we need to look at. Like what Sham was saying, in the US, like I went through the US system after NS, and I got to say, after my national service, right, I never did my best times, you know. I mean,
even in that 2 years.
After my national service, I never did my best times. So that is just one just my personal point of view, that is detrimental to an athlete's progression.
Kunalan, I mean, you were teaching physical education. You should be familiar. How crucial are those 2 years from an athlete?
You know, if you bring in national service, then the question is this: what about the girls? They don't have national service, so they should be performing.
Hmm. So you're saying, but maybe the girls just can't perform?
Yeah.
I'm going to die. I was joking. Okay.
I think Mr. K, you bring a valid point, but I think, like, for swimming, you have Jocelyn, you have Pat Chan, you had Tao Li. They didn't have to go through national service. And look at what levels they achieved. Even our table tennis girls, they do fantastically well. I think our men, they do have the talent. It's just about seeing... Where do you want to cut off? I don't think that everyone should be given this exemption. Yeah. I think if you open the doors too wide, it leaves a lot of...
It's a thorny issue.
Yes.
And maybe this is a... Sorry, PC, you want to say something? Yeah.
That is not an issue of the National Service. I don't believe in that. The government has set up the National Service. You have to go and serve. You see, like myself, when I was 19...
You didn't do national service.
Yes, I do.
You did?
I'm a Singapore citizen, okay?
Yeah, but you did.
I did.
Okay.
You see, I defer it. Because, you know, when I was in the PEEP form, when I was 1920, when I was waiting for the Olympic Games and all that, I wrote in to the government and says that, you know, I'm not prepared to go serve the national service. They allowed me. Okay, you wait for the 2 or 3 more years. Then in the age of 25, I went for the recruit. And I served. You see, it's all in the game, you see. If you really need it, go to the government and talk to them. Tell them.
The government is here.
Yeah. No. He, when I was running, he's only 3 years old.
Okay.
So now I tell you. You see, there's not an issue for the national service because there's government set up. You have to go through the national service.
But you see, deferments are not as easy these days. Sorry, yes.
Okay. Yeah. I'm actually a former sports school athlete, student athlete. So... in sports school, everything is already catered to you in a way that all your timetables are already made for you. So you have the struggle of balancing sports and studies because all is in your timetable. But then what happens is when you graduate from sports school, and that's how suddenly, oh my God, everything is different. And how are you, like, you feel like suddenly you have to adapt to a lot of things. And also in sports school, you stay there, like most of us stay there. So there's less traveling. Now when you're out of there, you have to travel, you have to juggle between your sports and then your studies, and you go to from tertiary, like from poly to uni, and everything just gets more difficult. If we could have this system whereby from sports school and then till uni, that'd be better. So that psychologically as well, like student athletes have to, you know, be better prepared and like adapt to so-called, you know, outside world, as in how you have to juggle between both, because it's different when you're in
world.
Sports school.
Yeah, thank you. Gary.
Touching on the point, I think, are we looking at sports school to spearhead Singapore sporting excellence, or are we looking to the schools as a whole, the education system, to actually provide the volume for the athletes? I think that's more critical in a sense, rather than focusing everything on the sports school itself, because we know that, you know, we do need the volume, we need the culture in place, and then when people are willingly sending their kids to sports school to really, you know, want them to do well, and then they see a pathway that, you know, sports has a future. I think these are some things that, you know, we have to look at.
Okay. So far we talked about culture, right? And the culture cannot be just top-down culture. It's got to be parents, family, all of us need to take ownership, including the community, need to take ownership, right? And then sports school as maybe one of the pathways, right, for you to be able to produce. But it cannot be the only one, right? So when you look at this entire thing, I guess this is what, Tekin, you talked about in creating an ecosystem. So what's your comment, what's your response to some of the suggestions and ideas that came up?
I think everybody's comments have been valid insofar as you look at the specific context of your sport and you say, okay, my sport is well served by having it included in the sports school. What have we seen? Sports school has been very important for sports that don't have a large club ecosystem. Right? If you don't have a large club ecosystem which are nurturing athletes at the club level, for high performance, you have to then centralize. And when you begin to centralize, then the sports school is a real blessing.
Mm.
There are other sports where the sports school is but one center, and there are other centers of excellence in the ecosystem that actually help to keep the sports school on its toes. And the sports school in the last review has had to ask, why do I continue to keep this sport in the school? Do I need to? How do I support the other talents that are out there? So I think the sports school review is starting to look at youth sport development to say that I need a combination of support systems. A system that houses them in one institution, a system that supports youth athletes who are in another part of the education system, and across a wider range of sport from individual to team. An ecosystem is what this is about. And together with the schools, together with ActiveSG, together with private clubs and private institutions, and our national sports associations, it's very critical that they're on board on this. We want to build the technical capability and the capacity and to adapt to different circumstances. Now, I'm speaking in general.
Yeah.
I'm speaking in general. And I think when we go to a very specific sport, and let's say track and field, today track and field benefits a lot from sports school because the clubs are not quite filling a void in terms of technical capability. But we do hope to build a vibrant club system from the ground up to enable us to tap on what is essentially a much easier sport to play over a lifetime.
Right.
And to bring more people into it. So we start again from the sports school and we begin to build other centers of excellence.
Yep. And that will take time.
I mean, yes.
Trying to connect, you know, it'll take time. You know, Minister, perhaps you want to respond to the point about national service.
I think before I touch on the point of national service, you know, here we are talking about sports and how important it is, and obviously as sportsmen, and we all know the value of sports. But in the overall scheme of things, sports is just one part of life. Just as there are others, parents, students, individuals who feel that arts are important, or, you know, in social work, or different things. So sports is one thing. When we look at it, when we wear the hat as a sportsman or enthusiast, we champion the cause, but that's one cause amongst many. Right? So what I said earlier is that we need to set up the whole ecosystem. I think sports school, I think we're quite clear, plays an important role, but it doesn't supersede, I think, the rest of the other parts. I think the tendency sometimes we have is that when we look at one thing, we just look at a silver bullet. There's no one silver bullet. It is really a whole series of different initiatives. And the key thing is that how do we coordinate it in a way that's complementary and reinforcing? There will be overlaps, but there are certain things that there are niche areas which sports schools excel in. There'll be some things that the clubs will excel in. Now, bringing this point about the different areas of interest, because when we talk about national service, if we are just only interested in sports and having Singapore excel in sports at all costs, then clearly, if you don't have the 2 years of national service plus NS responsibilities, wouldn't it be easier? It would be, right? I mean, as Mr. Kunalan mentioned, I mean, our girls don't do national service. So does that naturally translate to the fact that they will all therefore naturally excel? So I raise that point because for Singaporeans, that's part and parcel of our life and responsibility as Singaporeans to serve our national service. Now, it certainly is inconvenient in a sense, especially for some sports, perhaps not all, but for many sports, we know that it comes at a critical stage of the development. What happens? I mean, even Joseph, when he defers, it's not his exam from national service, he defers, but at some point he needs to come back and clock up his 2 years. And Joseph's development will go on for quite a few more years, so that conversation will still need to be addressed at that stage. So it's part and parcel of our landscape as Singaporean men that we need to serve, because do we think that security and defence is important? Do we think that national service is an important part of that landscape? So if given that that's one part of our responsibility, then how do we then organise ourselves so that we can try to see if some balance can be struck? And I think that's where the space, the conversations need to be taken.
But surely I think we can perhaps pay a little bit more attention to the possibility of deferment. It shouldn't be given too easily, but I'm just wondering whether MCCY and SNOC is currently negotiating this matter to come to an understanding with the Ministry of Defence, because there is a downside to it.
So now, clearly this is something that we have to address. For example, Joseph has been deferred. So there's a question where you draw the line. If you draw the line here, then there'll be some athletes that would qualify. If you draw the line slightly lower, and you have to define where that line is. But this is for deferment. But short of deferment, are there alternative arrangements? I know it's not ideal, right? But could you work out arrangements where training time can still be afforded, individuals are able to take time out, and a lot of this actually could be local. Because actually, if you are able to make arrangements with the local commanders, but sometimes for some appointments and jobs, that flexibility is there as well.
The problem is it becomes an ad hoc.
So it becomes ad hoc. So it's a bit not so structured. So I think what you need to is then relook at how important this is. How do you then reconcile with our other responsibilities as national servicemen? And then see whether some of these can move from where it is today.
Yeah. We have about 5 minutes more. I just want to wrap by going back to two points that are linked. One is Sham's point about tertiary. At the tertiary level, you were making reference to the US universities, right? What that means really is that if you want our tertiary institutions, institutes of higher learning, to have that buzz, then we would need to accept that we'll have foreigners in Singapore, right? A lot more foreigners to create that critical mass. They need not all become citizens, right? Many of the people who train in the US universities don't become US citizens. But are we prepared to have a lot more foreign international standard athletes in amidst us? Are we prepared for that? You know, I think that's what it entails. Yes, Mark?
I think there's one way to solve it, bringing more foreign talent in. I still think that we still need foreign talent. But if you look at, let's say, Japan and Korea, It's a lot of it is curbing the attrition at a certain rate. Their university competitive scene is still very vibrant, and they're able to produce Olympic champions at the most competitive sports as well. So it's not about bringing foreign talent as well. It's about curbing their attrition and making the allowances for athletes at the university levels.
It's a great point. I don't think they're mutually exclusive, right?
They're not.
I think you want to curb the attrition at the same time, or the seepage. At the same time, you want to have the buzz. And the buzz cannot be done incestuously. You need to bring in buzz from outside. You know, Teck Yin, you want to comment on this?
I think when you look at the Chinese, Korean, Japanese systems, they are very highly centralized. And they bring the universities into a very centralized system, which is quite different from a system like the American system that promotes a lot of choice and is dispersed across multiple educational institutions. So the actual number of people that go through this system in Korea or Japan is very small. However, I think in Singapore's context, we don't force feed people into that university. We don't say to someone, you as a Singapore athlete, you have to go to NUS. You as a Singapore athlete, you have to go to within a school of business within NUS. You have no choice. In the Korean system, it's very centralized. So I think the question really is, for a particular sport, does it make sense to establish a sport ecosystem that involves the local university that will also attract a good training pool that comes not just from Singapore, but from around the region. So silat is an interesting example. It is a sport that is indigenous to this region. I can imagine that you could have a world-class training system in Singapore for pencak silat that includes a university education, that includes proponents from across the region who come here to study and to practice that sport. But it may not work for swimming.
It may not, but I think the idea is interesting in the sense that we today have a significant number of universities, right? Five national universities, right? Nationalized universities with funding. So these universities can each start developing that character and the personality associated with certain sports. It's possible, right? My question is whether the government through SNOC or Sport Singapore is in a position to start mooting the idea with the universities.
I think we've mooted the idea with the universities to allow a certain flexibility for our sports people to be able to cope with their training and fulfilling their course requirements. And our universities have been very forthcoming with regard to that. Whether or not the university can create that atmosphere, that culture for high performance training to take place within the university setting, we're not short of facilities. The question is whether we have a critical mass of athletes who are there.
And that may help, you know, take care of the attrition and the leakage to some extent. Ben, quick comment on this?
Yeah, I think the universities, like you mentioned, five universities, we do have the critical mass, and you want to encourage the inter-university rivalry. That is where the buzz comes from.
Yep.
Right? You don't need foreigners to create a buzz. It's the local buzz that is exciting enough. Oh, and
Let's look at some statistics. Huh? 50,000 kids play national school sports. By the time you reach IHL, the number of competitions that you have and the participation rate comes down to 3,000.
From 50,000?
50,000 across different levels. Huh? So if you look at each cohort is about 12,000, 10,000.
Okay.
Once you get down to the IHLs, the polite games, the IVP games, you're down to 3,000 students. A lot of your sportsmen have left the local system. They are in systems across the world. They're not just in our local universities. A lot of the national school sportsmen decide that I'm going to retire, I'm going to move on to something else because I don't intend to represent Singapore necessarily. And of course, you don't necessarily get a credit in your university for participating
sure.
in sport.
Sure.
Right. So, again, I say it's a question of whether for that particular sport, there is every reason to establish a world-class training center in Singapore. And the universities can be part of that.
Okay.
Ben. Apart from just being passive and allowing the students to do different sports and giving them choices, I think the universities need to be more proactive and actively set up a league amongst the universities.
Yep.
And if you consider the IHL, you combine the universities together, the polytechnics, the numbers are substantial.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's an interesting point, something that maybe
the
government
platform,
can look at.
Right, like the
I'd like to now wrap with this point. This issue of recognition. Recognition for people who have served. You see, a friend of mine recently told me that a key incentive for you to be part of a group is when you observe how those who have retired are treated. You know what I'm saying? So there is some discussion as to whether we are recognizing our homegrown heroes and icons over the years. The Hall of Fame has been set up. I think that's a great move. The Youth Olympics Museum has been set up. But do you feel that more can be done to recognize our own homegrown icons? And you don't have to be necessarily 80 before you are considered an icon. You don't have to be Tan Hao Liang. There are many other people. At some point, you've retired, you've moved on, but you need to be recognized. How can this be done? And this goes back to the whole point of culture too. It goes back. Do we have a tradition of that? You know, I'd like to hear your views on that. Yes. Maybe, yes.
So I've been tasked to form
task. By whom?
By my bosses.
He's a Sports Singapore employee.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Task by whom?
So, we are in the process of now forming a group. We need a name for this group. At one time, we thought we might call it alumni, but I think we are looking for a better name.
Paikia.
And then, and we are saying that we want to be inclusive. That means if you have represented Singapore in sports, whether as an athlete, coach, or official, we are going to recognize you. We're going to trace them, we're going to register them, and then we are looking for some benefits for them. So that is in the pipeline.
How long is this pipe?
I'm 73 now. No, but I, you know, I'm part of it. And
yeah.
I really think we want to do something. And right from the top is people want to recognize and want to do things for them. So we are there. We just have to get going.
Wonderful.
But can we do what other countries are doing? 2 years ago, India came up with a scheme. If they are Olympic medalists, Asian Games medalists, and lower, they get a monthly...
like a pension.
Pension. Olympic medalists, 10,000 rupees a month for life. And 10,000 rupees a month is like $300. You can live very comfortably in India. That's what they told me. Can we do that?
Maybe the former...
Do we need to do that? You know, this is what is happening in other parts of the world. In Korea, the same.
So basically,
in Malaysia, the same.
So basically, Kunal, what you're saying is we need to come up with incentives that that make a difference. It need not all be monetary, but
yeah.
That makes
so
a difference.
So what makes a difference for us Singaporeans, sportsmen and women who have retired?
Sure.
So that's my job now to ask, so find out, and so on.
PC Supaya has been dying to give you some ideas.
Sorry, I have to say this, you see. I've been working for Singapore Pools for 41 years. You see, so the already retired for 4 years. They just call me and says, "Okay, your time already 62. You have to leave." So I wrote in and I spoke to them. You see, what happened? Why? You see, this is our scheme. We have to reduce the staff and all that. Otherwise, we have to cut your pay for 20% and all that. Give you a different job and all these things. I say, okay, I have to leave. You see, I will say we have done so much. Not to say myself or whatever it is. I'm talking on behalf of every. Olympians, we reached the highest spot is Olympic. We have been there. We've been participating and all that. The company should be proud of that. I have an Olympian here. You see, we can do so many things. You can bring the staff for the jogging, training and all that. You can even create something for us. You see, and I prefer what Kunal was telling. Retirement, there's no retirement for the sportsmen. They retire themselves if they are not fit. Look at me, whether I'm fit or not. You see? So I lose the job. Then I have to go and create something else. So I spoke to Kuna. I'm the Olympian, we are in the committee, and spoke to Kuma. Kunalan is coming with something that he's going to approach and all that, you know, all this. You see, there's an Olympian who have a taxi driver, Noraza Hamid. He's a taxi driver. When we call him, he doesn't want to come. He's a taxi driver. You see, Yogencha is a taxi driver. You see, are we feeling proud? The Singaporean, all the, you know, sportsmen, whichever Olympic, and driving taxis and all that, whichever, you know, we got to take care of them. You see, some of them, even my neighbor, Malaysia, I was born in Malacca. I'm a Malaysian. But I've been given a Singapore citizen and I'm here. But Malaysia, they're taking care of all the sportsmen. You see? So one way or the what sir says, you know, you don't have to give them a reward of cash or whatever. It's one way or the other. If they go to the medicals, they got special treatment. We take a bus, they got a special treatment. Or look for them a job. You see, when they got to get, example, the schools, they have the PE teachers and all that. We can be, you know, take over that and we can promote the sports.
Okay.
You see?
So it doesn't have, it could even be medical. mental, yes, things that are useful for you. Kadir, I saw you responding, reacting when PC was saying you want to pass with the
because mic? Because both of them went for the Olympic in 1972. This is the one way, you know, PE teachers. You see, yeah, that doesn't mean you must be a PE teacher. How he knows about sports? We can be a sports officer there.
We will get do them, something. I'll get them to respond to you.
Yes, please. Thank you.
Yes, Kadir.
At least he was working. I have stopped my work about 30 years ago to stop working to do coaching, to help the kids, to bring up the kids. I have no salary. I do my own pocket money, whatever I did. 3/4 of my life in sports, from my competing and coaching, continue non-stop until today.
Luckily, your wife is working.
Yeah. Lucky she's working. She's very helpful to me. She knows I'm the public property. Before I married her, I told her that I'm a public property, so you don't disturb me.
Wife works for Sports Singapore.
Yeah. And that's where I met her in sports.
No, but I think you're making an important point, a very important point. This shouldn't happen.
Yeah.
I mean, personally, if you ask me as a Singapore citizen, it shouldn't happen. You know, I mean, there must be at least some form of support, financial support for people who are serving the country, serving the nation. Thank you for your contribution. Kokpan, yeah. I want to hear from you. Sorry, this has to be the last comment.
My sense is, taking back to our initial discussion where we feel that sport play a very important role to bring the youth together and hopefully they do good for the country. Similarly, in their golden years, whether the recognition in the form of medical or even SAFRA sports team facilities. And I think the SAFRA, the NS, they have a very good sporting facilities to all the ex-NS men, and I'm one of the beneficiaries. I think that's something that we can maybe borrow some very good ideas for the folks here. But I think the key point I would like to raise is this, right? It's about what is the signal that we are sending to the community that on the one hand, we want sports to be the single defining area to bring people together, to rally, and with their heart sing Singapura. And the people who are the catalysts that bring this about, at the golden years, they kind of, based on the feedback, they felt as though they're missing out on something. And I think this discussion actually warrants some very serious consideration. And when I look at our DPM, Taman, he himself was a hockey player, and I'm very, very sure he could also relate to this. He was a hockey player, taking time, and I'm sure, I think in today's world, I think in our leadership team, and after this evening's session, I have my separate discussion on NSAs, by the way, I really believe the moment is right. SG50 is a good initiative. You can actually add a bonus to many, many other sportsmen. And actually, it gives a real hope for the younger athletes, yeah, that they say, hey, guess what? Symbolically, things have changed. And I think this is something that I hope, the forum here, the panelists would actually put a little bit more, or not a little bit more, really put in consideration for this. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Kwan. A quick comment from our panelists, maybe starting with Teck Yin.
I think we have recognized that we do have to prepare our athletes for their post-athletic career. So in I won't say in recent times, because it's been around for a while, we have been facilitating furthering of studies, we have been facilitating job placement, we have been facilitating skills upgrading for athletes that would benefit from that. But when you look at the complete universe of Team Singapore athletes, this notion of an alumni is something that we have to find a way to activate. I think no elite sportsman, I don't believe anyone, wants to feel that I'm getting a handout.
Yeah.
Right? That here's some charity. I think nobody, no athlete worth his salt believes that I'm not earning the money that I get. And the question is, how do we activate an alumni in the true sense of the word alumni, which is part of a larger network? A network of people that can support, help, assist when there is an athlete who needs that help. And certainly from a Sports Singapore point of view, we will come in when there is a need, where there is a market failure, to see what we should do, what we can help to do. But the first starting point is, how do we all help ourselves? Mr. K could have retired years ago, but he's a very active staff member whose major role is in inspiring the young. So for years, he was out at Kay Siang Road, activating ex-Olympians to come to the Youth Olympic Museum to share their stories with the younger generation that are visiting the museum. Terry Padmanathan is working for me. He works down on the ground on football programs, right, to try and get our youth to start to play football. He's a highly decorated national captain and a well-qualified coach. So come down to the ground to do the work. And I think Terry is very proud that he's able to do that. But the alumni allows us to reach out to more and more people. And I think we would certainly be able to work very hard at the alumni, especially when there are cases that we can help.
Thank you. Ben.
Viswa, can I pose an inconvenient question myself?
Sure.
This SEA Games has shown Singapore that sports is a huge industry. It's something that Singaporeans can excel and strive to do well. Or to mark the occasion and as an incentive for us to move forward, to do even more, to go to greater heights. What I'd like to see is the word sports being put back into the name of the ministry, the sports ministry. And I recall when it was removed, it was removed in 2012, in the midst of the Olympic Games. And that was something that stuck with me. And what I hope to see is the name being put back into sports to show that we as a nation take sports seriously. We recognize the effort of our athletes, and it's something that is worth striving for.
It's not just words, right? It's a powerful signaling effect, you know. Thank you, Minister.
Just to clarify, MSF, not MCCY. but I relate back to the point I raised earlier. I see, we're here with panelists, and many of you here as sportsmen, and obviously you're wearing the hat as sportsmen. You feel that as sportsmen, you need to be recognized. Actually, building Singapore, there are many people who built Singapore. And our world doesn't, and much as we like it to be, but our world doesn't revolve around sport alone. But sport plays an important part. But neither does our world revolve around one particular issue. Just as, you know, I talk about silver bullets, we sometimes look at it as if this is the only thing and that's it. But because we're discussing this topic, and it's a frightfully important topic, because sports does many wonderful things. But there are also many other things, there are many other Singaporeans serving and contributing in very significant ways, perhaps not quite so glorious. They don't have the moment in the sun. They're understated behind the scene. Nurses, many people providing our social workers, for example, doing jobs which are emotionally very draining, but they never get up on the podium. For example, are their jobs any less important? Any less contribute, you know, do they contribute any less to the building of our nation? They don't. But each of us play a part. So I think when we call for recognition, I think it's correct. I think we should acknowledge, and I think that's what we've tried to do. For example, the Pioneer Generation package was all Singaporeans of that generation, regardless of what you did, even regardless of your background. So I think the sports is in, I think it's an exciting time. You know, so it really behooves us to see how we ride on the momentum. Not just focus on resources, but I would say what we as Singaporeans, the kind of choices we make, how do we contribute to that space? It's not just government deciding, not just SportSG deciding, not just the NSAs, but really all of us. And now I was very particular as we build up the SEA Games, when we talk about Team Singapore, Team Singapore isn't just about the sportsmen. It isn't just about the sports administrators, not just about the government agency supporting. It's about all of us. As supporters, what's our role supporting Team Singapore? And when you look at it beyond just sport, Team Singapore is actually much bigger than that, but we play a big part in galvanizing that, and it's frightfully exciting times.
Thank you. I'm, as a host of this program, I'm particularly delighted that we've got the privilege of having this discourse. I think it's a moment for us to reflect. before any major takeoff, I believe strongly it's important for us to pause and reflect and listen to each other before sprinting. And I think we've had some very particularly sobering suggestions and ideas that have surfaced today. Sobering, because if we keep an open mind, we will see the sense in some of the points that have surfaced. And I hope the government and all of us will keep an open mind. It is not a zero-sum game. It is not about having foreigners or Singaporeans. I think it is about Singapore. What is best for our country? But one thing that's very clear that's come through here is, at the end of the day, sports, like anything that requires the heart, talent alone is not going to make you win. I think those of us who have played sports know it. Talent alone is not going to. It is the spirit, the human spirit, that gives you the triumph in the end. Am I right? And that human spirit cannot come just from facilities. Facilities can help. That human spirit cannot just come from your parents telling you to do something. That spark has to be there. And very often that spark comes with something that inspires you. And as far as I'm concerned, the greatest inspiration that we can give to the next generation is how we recognize and treat those who have worked hard for us and this country that we call home. Any society, any organization that does not treat its the people who built it well suffers in the long run. And I hope that it'll not be too late for us to start building on this. And on that note, I'd like to thank you all once again. I'd like to thank the Minister for joining us, Ben, Teck Yin, and all of you. And on behalf of IQ, I'd like to say a big thank you to the sportsmen and women of Singapore. Well, it leaves me now to ask you at home to join us in this debate. Share your views, share your perspectives. Log on to our website, www.inconvenientquestions.sg. Follow us on Twitter and Facebook for the latest news. And watch our previous debates on our YouTube channel. Remember, you ask, they answer, we make it happen. This has been IQ, Inconvenient Questions.